A Union Army soldier was most likely a slim young man, a little over 5'8", with brown hair and blue eyes. He was also probably a farmer and a Christian. Most Confederates were of a similar description. Union records indicate more than 2 million soldiers were ages 21 and under, with only 10% being over 30. Though there were extremes in both directions, old and young. Older soldiers were typically officers or in more specialized roles. Young soldiers often lied about their age in order to serve or acted in other roles such as company musicians. Maintenance of discipline in both armies was a problem. Looting, drunkenness, desertion, and theft were rampant, and military justice was often swift and harsh. Both sides suffered from disease, poor hygiene, and a lack of sanitation. More soldiers would die from disease than in battle. Diseases which affected soldiers included such things as measles, typhoid fever, malaria, pneumonia, tuberculosis, scarlet fever, and amoebic and bacterial dysentery. Lice were also a constant irritation for soldiers, as opportunities to wash clothes and bathe were rare. Soldiers from rural areas had an advantage initially, though after a year of active duty, though, these differences were negligible. Comradeship among soldiers were forged through shared dangers in battle. The soldiers often reported fear before battles and depression afterwards, which was known as survivor's guilt. The Union Army had the advantage of being better equipped and supplied, while for the Confederates, battlefield requisition became the prime means of supply. Little priority was given to replacing uniform components in both armies, and the commissary took a backseat to the ordnance department, but still trumped the quartermaster. On long marches, soldiers were required to carry a musket, cartridge box, which carried up to 40 rounds, a cap pouch, and a bayonet. In their heavy knapsacks, soldiers also carried eating utensils, their daily rations, and camp gear. These knapsacks were described by some soldiers as a chaos of straps and buckles. Only a tiny fraction of time was spent in actual frontline combat. The majority of their time was spent in camps. During fair weather campaigning season, soldiers were expected to engage in a battle one day out of 30. The remaining days were filled with drilling, punctuated with spells of entertainment in the form of music, cards, and other forms of gambling. The arrival of newspapers or letters and packages from home were a cause for celebration. Much time was then left to exposure because of poor shelter, unhealthy food, lack of hygiene, and the raves of sickness and disease. Union soldiers were issued a dog tent or shelter half for their sleeping accommodations. This was a 6-foot square with a row of buttons and buttonholes on three sides. Two men would pitch their tents together by connecting their two pieces and propping them up with sticks. Their camp rows also included a rubberized blanket to lay on the ground and a wool blanket to shield from the cold, but one or both were often tossed on long marches or upon entering combat, leading to greater exposure to the elements. The soldiers' ration varied from plentiful to scarce. Union troops by far had the best rations on paper, but the logistical difficulties inherent in feeding armies of tens of thousands led to shortages. Their rations included hardtack, 3/4 pound of salt pork, and 1 1/4 pound fresh meat, coffee, sugar, and salt allotments. Fruits and vegetables were scarce for soldiers on both sides, and an attempt was made by the Union by issuing desiccated vegetables, which was meant to be boiled. However, much of the vitamins and minerals were lost in this process. The Confederates found it difficult to deliver full rations to its troops. The Confederates adopted the same ration as the Union, but reduced it in 1862 as fresh meat and coffee became increasingly scarce. Confederates more often had to forage for any kind of fresh vegetables. Foraging, of course, being a synonym for theft. Cavalry soldiers were often looked down on by common foot soldiers as dandies on horseback. They were used as shock troops, advance scouts, in reconnaissance, and as escorts for generals. The most important piece of equipment for a cavalryman was his horse. Keeping it in top condition was the goal of every trooper. Replacements were generally easy to obtain for the Union Army, but more difficult for Confederates, as the Confederates had to bring their own horses. If no replacement could be found for a soldier, they were often reassigned to the infantry. Many soldiers decided to enlist in the Navy, preferring life on a ship to the hard-marching life of a foot soldier. Much of their time was spent in the maintenance of their ship and in drilling. Free time was spent writing and reading letters, reading newspapers and books, repairing clothing, and playing games like dominoes. Cards were strictly forbidden, as well as any other form of gambling. Some ships would even have resident bands, or at least one or two men on board who played an instrument. Abuse of alcohol was common among all ships and in all ranks. And for some sailors, life away at sea proved too much and would slip into deep despairs known as land sickness as a result of prolonged boredom. In fact, of all the ship-to-ship fighting put together, would total less than 1 week of battle out of the four-year war. Many soldiers rushed to enlist, blinded by patriotic fervor and a desire for heroic adventure. But it is important to remember that the individual soldiers' attitudes were not necessarily the same as those belonging to Abraham Lincoln and Jefferson Davis. Every Northerner was not an abolitionist, nor Southerner a slave owner. For many, they were merely compelled by the promise of a regular paycheck. In all, roughly 3.5 million fought, and 620,000 gave their lives in the war between the states, and it is our duty to remember their sacrifice.